طلع البدر علينا لثنيات يدها وجب الشكر علينا مدعا لله دا أيها
الربيع الأول which means in English spring, the first spring. This month, dear brothers and sisters, in this month, our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the mercy of the worlds, the gifted mercy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was born in this month. It is really, I think it's really important that we mention this occasion. And let's see what our scholars, what the Quran, and what the hadith of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mention on this occasion. So, some of the ayat, Shaykh Ali, may Allah reward him, read, وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in this surah, Surah Ali Imran, remember the blessing, the blessings and the favor of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had favored you with when you were enemies. You know that the Arabs, some Arab tribes, fought with each other for years just for a horse. For years just for a horse, a she-horse. And many people were killed just for a horse. So when our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam came, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, remember, and telling particularly those Arabs, remember the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over you when you were enemies. And by His favor you became brothers. وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَى شَفَى حُفْرَةٍ مِّنَ النَّارِ فَأَنْقَذَكُمْ مِنْهَا. And you were about to be in hellfire, but He saved you. How He saved them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, through our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The mercy, the gifted mercy, as He said, إِنَّمَا أَنَا رَحْمَةُ الْمُهْدَاتِ. I am not but a gifted mercy. And Allah said this, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. He's a mercy, not only for people, for people, for animals, for things, for all the worlds, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, what does he say about his birth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Did he mention his birth? Anyone has an idea if the Prophet mentioned his birth in any hadith? Do you know that the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used to fast Mondays and Thursdays? Right? We all know this, and alhamdulillah, many of you do this. Once, as in Sahih Muslim, he was asked, why are you fasting on Monday? Why do you fast on Monday? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is a day on which I was born. That is a day on which I was born. And on which I received the revelation. So he recognized his day, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his birthday. Did not he? He recognized his birthday, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that day was special and honorable and blessed. And this month of Rabi' al-Awwal is blessed because of that day. And this is why he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, thanked Allah for his birth and for his coming to the world. How? By fasting. So it is sunnah to fast on Monday having this intention. So the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in this hadith two births, two types of births. The first one, his birth as a child, as Muhammad, the son of Abdullah ﷺ. And the other birth is the birth of the messenger Muhammad ﷺ. So both of them are necessary. The second one would not have been without the first. And that the first would have not been completed without the second. So we, dear brothers and sisters, especially in this country, and even in Muslim countries, in this materialistic life, we need to connect our hearts to this beloved Prophet ﷺ. We need to teach our children that this day he was born. And Sayyidina Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has in the authentic narrations, he mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ was born on the, what day of Rabi' al-Awwal? The 12th. According to the vast majority of Muslim scholars, and Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas is one of those who hold this opinion, he said he was born on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On this day, the light came. Yes, it is as he narrated, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he is the call of Ibrahim, ana da'watu akhi Ibrahim. I am the call that was responded to Ibrahim, because Ibrahim prayed that, oh Allah, send among them one, a messenger from among themselves. So he is the call of Ibrahim, and he is the glad tidings of Isa alayhi salam. Because Isa alayhi salam, as Allah tells us in the Quran, he gave the glad tidings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدٍ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, my mother saw a light when she gave birth to me, with that light, the palaces of Syria were lightened. It reached the palaces of Syria. That is a light that he tells that his mother saw, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is authentic. And this is also an indication that he will be the one who will bring these people out of darkness into light. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in surah, in many surah in the Quran and in many ayat, in surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. There has come to you from your Lord, from Allah, نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ, a light and a clear book. What is the light that came to us? Imam al-Tabari, Shaykh al-Mufassirin, the Shaykh of Mufassirun, the Salaf scholars, or the main Salaf Mufassir, what did he say? He said, the Nur in this ayah, the light in this ayah, is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A light came to you and a clear book. يَهْدِي بِهِ اللَّهُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ رِضْوَانَهُ سُبُلَ السَّلَامِ وَيُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ بِإِذْنِهِ. Allah will bring people through the Prophet ﷺ from darkness into light. As also he says about Sayyidina Musa, أَنْ أَخْرِجْ قَوْمَكَ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Take your people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Sayyidina Musa, as in Surah Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, take your people out of darkness into light. وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِكُلِّ صَبَّارٍ شَكُورٍ. And remind them of the days of Allah. What are the days of Allah? The days of Allah, as Imam Ibn Kathir and Imam Tabari, these great Mufassirun, as they said, in though there are special days on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showered people with the great blessings and favors. As he saved the people of Israel, the children of Israel, when they followed Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, he favored all humanity and all the creation when he sent the messenger, his messenger, his best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyid waladi Adam, the master of the children of Adam, as he said in Sahih Bukhari, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahabi ajma'in. وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ. I am reminding you of this great blessing. We need to remember it, and we need to follow his guidance and follow his footsteps, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we need to feel the joy and happiness of his birth. Sayyidina al-Abbas, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once came to him, as Imam al-Bayhaqi, Imam Tabarani and others narrate. They say he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he told him, may I praise you with some poetry? He said, say, لا يفضل الله فاك. Say, may Allah protect you and protect your mouth. So he said, some verses of poetry praising the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and some of them, وأنت لما ولدت أشرقت الأرض وضاءت بنورك الأفق ونحن في ذلك الضياء وفي النور وسبل الرشاد نخترق. You are the one when you were born, the light came, and we are enjoying this light and taking our way out of taking our way through the ways of guidance. صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. So they praised him, they recognized his birth, صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he, صلى الله عليه وسلم, drew our attention that days and places, they do not have specialty by themselves. No, it is humans, it is the great people who honor certain places and who honor certain times. How? When he speaks about Friday, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says it is one of the best of days. Why? Why? He said because on which Adam was created. On Friday, Adam was created. So Friday has been an honorable day because an honorable great person was born on that day, Sayyiduna Adam. So what about the day on which the master of the children of Adam was born, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is not that a blessed day, an honorable day? Yes, and this is why he fasted every Monday, not only one day all over the year. No, every Monday he would fast in gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dear brothers and sisters, when we talk about our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we can never contain his characteristics. The scholars of hadith, they put special books about his life sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his biography and his characteristics and his physical characteristics, like Shama' al-Tirmidhi. You know, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba narrated to us each and every tiny detail about the physical description of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why would they do that? When we try to be, if he has a, for example, nice nose or it has a certain shape, we will go and try to make it like him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is the purpose, dear brothers and sisters? These are ahadith, this is deen, this is religion, these are ahadith that have been transmitted and one by one and in the hadith books. There is a reason. And who described him to us? These great sahaba who are the best of creation, the best people after prophets, are the sahaba, the friends, the companions of our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you know, they described his eyes, his eyebrows, his eyelashes, the hair on his chest. They said there were 13 white hairs in his beard. They described his shoulders. They described everything, his walking, his eating, his movements, his words, his teeth. They said there was some space in his teeth, between his teeth, and that's a sign of beauty among the Arabs. He was the most beautiful, the best good-looking person, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did they do that, brothers and sisters? And do we need to read that? Yes. Why the Sahaba narrated this to us? It's not just to keep it in the books. It's not just following his actions. No. Also, you need to know him. Why you need to know him? Why do we need to know his shape, his physical description? You need to know it. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ رَآنِي فِي الْمَنَامِ فَسَيْرَانِي فِي الْيَقَرَى. In the authentic hadith, he says, the one who sees me in the dream will see me in reality. You will be with him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you see him in the dream, you cannot come and say, oh, I saw the Prophet. Give us the proof. Describe him to us. Your description should match the description that the Sahaba described. When you learn about his physical description, you will love him. You will love him, you will absolutely love him when you will read about his characteristics. And the scholars made many books about his characteristics, his courage, his kidding. He used to kid with people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He once saw a woman and she told him, pray for me so that I'll be in paradise. He said, old women will not be in paradise. She got so sad. Then he told Sayyidina Aisha, tell her that she will enter paradise while or in the status of being young. She will not be old. Did not she read the Quran? Did not she read that? There will be no old men or women in paradise. Then she got happy. There are many, many amazing hadith. This is only a trigger, brothers and sisters, to myself and to you, just to read and learn and connect to this best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They described his courage. He was so courageous. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, he said, in the battles when it is so intensive and it is at the climax of the battle, we will seek protection in the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And on the other hand, those Sahaba will protect him with their bodies. As Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, or another Sahabi mentioned, one of the Sahaba, he said, by Allah, I saw his back on the Battle of Uhud, just like that. Al-Qinfid. Shul Qinfid, ya Shaykh?
Hedgehog.
The hedgehog. You know the hedgehog, how many needle, kind of needles in his back? This Sahabi, they said his back, because he was covering the Prophet, his back became just like the hedgehog. Also a woman, Sayyidah Nusayba bint Ka'b al-Maziniya, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I did not turn right or left, except that I found it and I saw it fighting in front of me, defending me. Even the women, one of the women came to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he came from one of the battles. Look what she said. Look their happiness with the safety of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, oh Allah's Messenger, I made a vow. I swore that if you come back safe from the battle, I'm gonna play on the duf next to your head, the tambourine. I'm gonna play on the tambourine in rejoice, in happiness that Allah brought you back safe from the battle. Is this a kind of ibadah? Playing on the tambourine? No. Yet, she made a vow, and the scholars said, if you make a vow to do something haram, you cannot do it, you should not do it. So the Prophet said, "Awfi bi nadrik, fulfill your vow." So she was laying on the duf next to his head, over his head, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in rejoice that Allah brought him back safe from the battle.
What are you saying?
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
I can't understand what's the
So as I said, when we speak about him, we have currents of ideas and stories and tradition and books and volumes on this. One last thing I would like to mention, which has relation to the ayat that the Shaykh read. And I think it is the most serious problem Muslims face. This is what I think. The most serious problem Muslims face in this age, in this time, is the divisions among the Muslims. Is our misunderstanding of the differences in our deen, our unreadiness, we are not showing readiness to accept the fact that this great religion, the final religion, the final message that is great and good for every place and every time, this comprehensive message, we are not, I'm talking about myself and about Muslims in general, as I think, we are not showing readiness to understand that we have differences. And this is why the result is, look, he's talking about the mawlid, astaghfirullah, this is bid'ah. Look, this is mushrik, he's saying Rasulullah. This, you see, he's khawarij. Yeah, this is murji', you see what he said, murji'. You see, he's following Shafi'i or Abu Hanifa, and he's not following the hadith. Do we find this or not? Is this a reality or not? This is the first level, brothers and sisters. And this is something you can see it online, on the comments, on the YouTube, on Facebook, on Twitter, and in real conversation with some brothers, here or there or anywhere. More seriously, brothers and sisters, this is leading to violence. This is leading to violence. This is leading to a Muslim killing a Muslim. Is that real? If you don't think it's real, then you're not living in this world. If you don't know that there's a group of youth here and there, they claim we're following the Quran and the Sunnah, and they're slaughtering Muslims, slaughtering. Then you don't know. What led them to this? Why would they kill those Muslims? Why would they kill those Muslims? Why? Because they did some actions and they believe, this is an apostate, this is murtad, an apostate. And since you are murtad of the deen, you have to be killed. And your wives, even they will, with some groups, they took their wives as slaves. As slaves, I read this week a magazine by ISIS. In English, they're narrating how they divided the slave, the women that they enslaved from those Yazidi tribe. They said, we have to divide them according to the Sharia. If you take two women, you take two women. Then they sold them. This is not media. No, this is their formal declaration. So, brothers and sisters, I believe this is the most serious problem we are facing. It is in the root level, in the easy level, it's causing division, it's causing hatred, it's causing, I'm very frank, and I'm very realistic. It will cause division to the extent, I know some people, they stopped praying behind some other Muslims just because they heard something about them. Just because they heard something. This is the beginning of division, brothers and sisters. This is a fact. Then it will, in other areas, it will be really violent and it will be killing. And we are witnessing this. Now, did our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam show us the guidance in regard with differences or not? This is the main question. This is, I believe, the main topic that we have to spread awareness about. Inshallah, I'm gonna try to briefly talk about this point, and you're free to leave, and I think, inshallah, I'll not take a long time, but you're free to leave anytime. But I think it's a good chance that there's no program today, and this is a very essential issue that I think we have to talk about, and I did not hear people talking about it. Our religion, dear brothers and sisters, have foundations that do not change. There are foundations in our religion that do not change over time, do not change from one person to another. Salah, Siyam, Zakat, adultery is forbidden, stealing is forbidden, drinking is forbidden. We know these, you don't have two opinions. But there are so many issues. Just to introduce myself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me. I studied 4 years in the Da'wah College in Damascus. And I studied more than 10 years with the scholars, the main scholars of Syria and the Arab world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more importantly than this, blessed me with a certificate in the Holy Quran from His Eminence Sheikh Fakri Tarabishi. He had the highest sanad in the Quran in the whole world. In the Da'wah College, there is a topic that we study. It's called comparative religion. No, comparative fiqh. Comparative fiqh. So, when you study comparative fiqh, it's similar when you study comparative religion. you study the four schools, the four main Muslim schools of thought, and by the way, there are many more schools of thought, but they did not have the chance to be recorded and to be cared for as the four main madahib, Shafi'i, Hanafi, Maliki, Hanbali. You all know, as in the constitution of this center, the constitution of this center states that this is for Ahl Sunnah, those who follow Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, Imam Malik radiallahu anhu, Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, ajma'in. These are the four imams that no Muslim in the world can or should criticize their authority. Yet, because of some Muslims not understanding this point, unfortunately, we have seen nowadays some, I don't want to say students of knowledge, no, some ignorant people, they are accusing Imam Abu Hanifa or Imam Shafi'i, he contradicts the Sunnah, he doesn't take the Sunnah, he rejects the Hadith. This is something we see. So in brief, I will mention two incidents in the time of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam that are more than enough for us to understand that this religion is a religion that has diversity, because it is the final message, because it is mercy for all peoples and all times and all places. So if you don't find the solution for your problem in the Shafi'i school, the scholar who is knowledgeable will find a solution for your problem in the Maliki school. If you don't find it in the Maliki, you'll find it in the Hanafi school. It is mercy.